Okay, so we will continue on to the next topic. We finished distributed file systems last time. Today we will do a quick overview of World Wide Web, caching in the web, cache consistency. When we had talked about consistency, I had mentioned that we will keep coming back to consistency topics in the context of specific systems. So we looked at distributed file system and saw how simple consistency techniques are used there. We look at the web where the consistency techniques are a little more sophisticated, but not vastly more so. And then we'll come back to other systems subsequently and see how the same principles apply. So what I'll do is first talk about the World Wide Web, HTTP protocol, introduce the notion of a web cache, then we'll look at cache consistency in that context and several different techniques. And we'll end with content distribution networks. So I should mention that some of these ideas are going to be used in Lab 3, which should be out today. It's the Lab 3 will include caching and fault tolerance. Okay, so you take your front-end servers, you add caches, and you also make them fault tolerant. The fault tolerance part we already covered. Caching we have covered in the abstract, but some of what you implement is what has been discussed today. Okay, so with that background, let's start with the web case study. So web systems are client-server systems. The client machine typically runs a browser. The server machine runs a web server. They talk HTTP. Browser makes request to the web server. Web server retrieves the requested content or generates the requested content, as the case may be, and sends the response back. In the more traditional static web content approach, the HTML pages and the JPEG images that are included, or any image that's included, are already generated as files, okay, and they're stored on the file system. So all that the HTTP request does is it specifies the name of a file or the name of an image, okay, and then the web server simply reads that file and sends it back as part of the HTTP response. So that's a static website. Most of the web's content today is dynamic, but the pages are not generated and stored. They are actually generated on the fly, as we will see. Now if you look at the client side, which is the browser, this is a picture of the various components of a browser. Browsers are typically multi-threaded. They have different modules. There's the user interface, that is the part that is the GUI that the browser presents to the user. There is the browsing engine, that's the part that is actually going to look at the links that you click on and generate requests and so on and send them off to the network. There's the rendering engine, which is the component that takes the content that's comes back and renders it. Okay? It puts the images in the right place, it takes the HTML, it takes the tags, whether they're what fonts and so on, and it begins to render it. And then there are a whole bunch of other modules. There is a parser to parse XML or HTML that comes from the server, communication module to communicate with the server. There may be client-side interpreters if your browser supports things like JavaScript, which most browsers do. You need an interpreter to interpret any JavaScript that's embedded in your HTML page and so on. Okay? That's a standard picture of how a browser works. We won't go into too many details there. Just, you know, quick overview. Okay. Now, as far as the modern systems go, rather than having a pure client-server architecture, they use a client-proxy-server architecture. So there is another component called a proxy, an intermediary that's going to sit in between the client and the server. This architecture is not just used in the web, it may be used in a variety of other contexts as well. Here, you see a proxy that sits in front of a FTP server. Okay, now you have an HTTP server and there's a proxy sitting in between. Now the goal of the proxy depends on what it is being used for. The simplest thing that the proxy can do is to have a cache. Okay? So rather than making a request directly to the server, your client is going to make a request to the proxy server. It's called a proxy server, that's the actual server. So it sends a request to the proxy server. The proxy server runs a cache. It's going to see if the requested web page is already stored in the cache. And if it's a cache hit, you can return that response immediately. Otherwise, you have to send, retransmit that request to the actual server, get the content, put a copy in the cache, and send the response back. Okay. So caching is something that many proxy servers do. Other proxies can do other things. They can do computational transformation. So for example, if you have a web page that is designed for a desktop browser, okay, you can have mobile proxies that take that page and reformat it so it fits on a phone, so for instance. So the screen is small, so the large web page may not render properly. So you do some simple transformations, change the layout, so you have the same content, but it is redesigned on the fly to reformat it on the fly, so it renders properly on the mobile. So proxies can do these kinds of transformation, which are called transcoding. More than web pages, the proxies are actually used when you're accessing video content from the web. They're often used to take, let's say, a high bandwidth stream and convert it into a lower bandwidth stream if you have a, let's say, a slow connection. So if you have a phone connection, you may not want to see it in HD quality on a small display. So then you are wasting a lot of bandwidth to get high quality video stream, and you can only view it at much lower resolution than phone may support. So in that case, your web proxy can actually transcode that video on the fly and reconvert it to a lower bitrate, which consumes less bandwidth and is more appropriate for the screen format that you want. Okay, so these are all the kinds of transformations a proxy can do. They can do caching, they can transform the content that's requested, and so on. We'll come back to proxies and caching in just a moment. So here, so we looked at the client, we talked about the proxy, now let's talk about the server. The server runs any HTTP server, and then behind the HTTP server, there may be other components if you have a multi-tier architecture, but as far as the HTTP server itself is concerned, it will employ some sort of an architecture to support concurrent requests. This is the one that the Apache web server uses, very popular web server for serving web content. Okay, so Apache web server, if you think, go back to the discussion we had maybe in the third or fourth lecture, when I talked about multi-threaded, multi-process, event-based servers. Okay, so those kinds of design considerations come into play here. Apache started off as a multi-process server. Okay, when Apache starts up, it spawns a number of processes, and there's a dispatcher or a master process that receives requests and it hands it off to the children to service. Okay, more modern versions of Apache are multi-threaded. Yeah, that means single process, lots of threads. There's a master thread and a set of slave threads, and request comes in, you hand it over to a slave thread. Okay. So variety of different architectures, but regardless of whether you're multi-process or multi-threaded, here is what the overall architecture looks like. So Apache is modular. There's a core component that's going to do basic HTTP processing. But you can extend the functionality of the server in many different ways by injecting what are called modules. Okay, modules are components that you can inject anywhere in the request processing pipeline. So what is shown here is the request processing pipeline. Request comes in, it's handled by the core of Apache and is handled, then given to module 1 and module 2 and module 3 and so on. And they may do a variety of different things. For instance, one module may be designed to encrypt the content before sending it up, if you're using HTTPS, for instance. There may be other modules that do PHP processing. If you have PHP code on the server, you execute that code on the fly. Okay, so you may be able to do PHP processing, a variety of other things. So when you configure your Apache system, you have to list what kinds of modules you want to support. And those modules will be loaded when the server comes up, and they will be used to process requests. Okay. Now, regardless of what modules are stored, the orthogonal dimension is whether you have multiple threads or multiple processes to support concurrency. Okay. In either of these two cases, you have a statically spawned pool of threads or processes, and the size of that pool is varied dynamically. Okay. As the load increases, you spawn more child threads or child processes, so you get more concurrency. So that's an orthogonal dimension to how this is a request processing pipeline, either within a process or within a thread. Okay. But you may have multiple processes or multiple threads to support concurrency. Okay. So it is not a request thread per request or a process per request model, where you create new threads as request comes in. You have a statically spawned pool. You hand over the request to one of the processes or threads in the pool, and the size of that pool is varied on the fly, depending on the load on the system. Okay? So that's the Apache web server. Now, as I said, that's the most simplest form of a web server is you only have Apache and static web content. In most complex websites, you have multi-tier architecture where you have an HTTP server. So this is a standard three-tier architecture that's shown in the picture here. The first tier is your HTTP server. Okay, it's a, could be an Apache server that is simply doing HTTP processing. Okay, a request comes in, but then that request in this kind of architecture don't access a static page. They're accessing a piece of content that has to be generated on the fly. Okay, to do that, the Apache web server will hand over your request to the what is called the application server or the middle tier. Okay, the application server could be written in Python, PHP, Ruby on Rails, any of the web frameworks that you know. It could be even modern versions of JavaScript or J2EE servers are very common in commercial environment. Okay, so the Java Enterprise Edition. So this is an app server. You write your web application here. Okay, this is where the application logic resides. So if you want to have an e-commerce store where you're selling products on the web, the store code is actually going to be in this process here. It could be written in Java, Python, whatever language you use, but all of that logic is here. Okay. So requests are handed to the application server. Application server will process that request, may make queries to a database server to retrieve any content. So if you have a store, again, your product catalog may be stored in a database, which is these are the products you're supposed to be selling. So if your request is simply searching on a keyword, then your program here is going to make a query on the database server saying, give all the product that match a certain string, for instance. Okay? All of those responses come back. They are then you construct a HTML page out of those responses on the fly. Okay? And then you give it back to the web server to send it back to the client. Okay? That's a typical request processing pipeline in a multi-tier architecture. Okay? HTTP front-end and middle app server, okay, written in a language of your choice. A backend database server which stores data content in the database. Okay, so this is how you will actually construct more complicated website that generate dynamic content. Any questions here? Now, you may have multi-tier architectures, but very high volume sites will not only have tiers, they will also have clustered or replica. Okay, so here you have to realize that your server has gone from being a single machine entity to potentially a multi-machine server. Okay? These components can all reside on one machine or they can reside on different machines. Okay? So if they reside on multiple machines, your web server is now, or website has become distributed. Okay? It has multiple components. Now each of these individual components can themselves be replicated. If the request volume is high, a single machine may not be able to service all the incoming requests. So you may have more than one of these app servers. You may have more than one of these database servers. Okay. So if you take this entire picture and draw a logical box saying that's your website or web server, then you will have, you cluster it, you will have something like this. Okay. Your front end switch where all the incoming requests come. This is simply a redirector or a load balancer, called a load balancer. Your incoming requests are then mapped onto one of these replicas. Think of each of these replicas as a multi-tier entity. Okay, so it's shown as a single box, but it could be a multi-tier entity. And so they are all replicated. So requests come in, they're mapped onto one of the servers. So you can do some simple load balancing to decide which entity gets which request. Okay, and then basically that will distribute the incoming load across a number of replicas. Now this switch has to be intelligent for many different reasons. In many cases, when you start a connect to a web server, you start a session. Okay? You may actually put something in a shopping cart when you're buying something online. Okay? The state of the shopping cart is your client state that is stored at the server. Okay? So depending on where you're requested, one of these replicas will store your state. If this front-end node simply just blindly load balances your request, next time you send a request, if it's sent to another replica, it will not have any knowledge of your shopping cart state. Okay? So you do load balancing at a session granularity, not a request granularity. Each time a new user connects, it's mapped onto a replica. All subsequent requests from that user within that session has to be sent to that replica. Otherwise, you will have incorrect state being accessed. Yes.
So all the session, like basically the entire session has to be dealt with by the front end, or can it actually forward, I guess, like setting up a session between the client and the specific web server directly?
Yeah, so the way it would work, there are many different architectures, we'll see a couple. The way it works is this is actually a switch. It's called a load balancer. All that is doing is when request comes in, it looks at who sent the request. If it's a new session, it will pick one of these websites and forward it. If it's an existing session, it will know where it had mapped and simply forward this request. In this case, all the rest of the end browsers only see this machine as having an address that represents the entire website. They don't actually see the presence of those machines, though those are hidden, because all the responses and requests are flowing through this website. Okay? That's one way to do it. Another way to do it is when a new session has started, you basically send your request here, but then that is forwarded to one of those websites, and all subsequent requests are directly sent there. Okay? In that case, the presence of these replicas becomes visible to the end user. There are both kinds of architectures. Okay, this where you hide it is more common because then you can vary the number of websites. All of that is happening internally. You don't have to tell the client, now there are six sites or five sites. You don't have to deal with that. But then that makes this entity a bottleneck because every request has to flow through it. Okay, no processing is happening here. This is simply a load balancing switch. It's a redirector. Okay, but nevertheless, all the requests flow through that entity and then the responses come back. So this is a web clustered architecture. So just what you just said is also shown here, which is a complicated set of sequence where the client first sends it to the load balancing switch. The load balancing switch may actually forward it to one of the websites. Okay? The websites may contact the dispatcher saying, should I take care of it or should somebody else take care of it? If the dispatcher says no, forward it somewhere else, okay, then in this case, you transparently do a TCP handoff to another of those replicas, and that is the one that is going to service the request. In this case, you'll see that the response went directly to the client without going through the switch. Then what that says is the presence of these web server replicas is now visible to the client. So all subsequent requests will then be actually sent directly to the server. The other way to have done it would have been to send it to the switch. The dispatcher is shown as a separate component. Typically, it runs on the switch itself. Okay, so you consult the dispatcher, say who should handle this session, and then you map it onto one of the servers. And that state is maintained in a table here. So all requests subsequently that come into the switch are directly sent. Okay, those are the two architectures. One is where the presence of the replicas is visible. The other is the switch makes it transparent. It handles all of the internal communication. Is that clear? Now, as I said, this entity which is shown as a web server could itself be a multi-tier entity, shown as a logical web server. But if you have dynamic content, that's not one entity, that could be multiple entities there. Okay? So the takeaway is designing high throughput, high performance websites is not simple. You'll see that the architecture has many different components. Some are distributed, some are replicated. And then you have to deal with how requests come in, how they get mapped onto multiple of these replicas, and so on and so forth. Okay. And you have very large websites may not have two, they may have several hundreds of these replicas, they may be distributed across multiple sites geographically and so on. Okay. So simple websites, no problem. You just set up Apache web server or some simple database that is accessed and you're done. But doing this for very high volume websites is a complicated process. Okay, many components have to be involved in servicing a single user request.
What is the difference between the distributor and the dispatcher?
What's the difference between the distributor and the dispatcher? So think of it as the dispatcher is the scheduler. Okay? That's the one that is going to decide when a session comes in which replica to actually access. What the distributor in this case is doing is it has the ability to forward a request to the web server that is local, or it has the ability to forward a request transparently to another replica if that web server doesn't want to deal with it. Okay. So this is the scheduler, this is the forwarding part of this entity. Okay, that's all that is. It's not a huge amount of difference. So in this case, because you're doing this at the TCP level, this is the architecture that I have taken from the book. So you basically, a distributor has to do some sort of a TCP connection handoff. So it should appear as if the client had actually connected to that site, not here, transparently. So it is doing some
you just hand off the connection as if that is where you had connected. That is why there is even some complicated logic. But in most cases, you don't need anything like that. You can do what is called HTTP redirect. You just simply start a new HTTP connection and send the original request. Any other questions on this? Okay, so I'm just going to quickly go through the type of HTTP requests and responses you can get. So HTTP is an old protocol that just allows you to retrieve any content. Okay, different kinds of content can be retrieved. Okay, and here are some that are common. Okay, you can have textual content. The most common one is HTML, that's plain text, or XML. Right? You can even get text content, you can get images, you can get video, audio, you can get MIME content, which is just encoded using some octet stream, and you can get PDFs and so on. Okay. So when the HTTP response comes back, the response has to tell you what is the type of content that is in the response. Okay. Response is basically some content that you retrieve. You have to say, is it HTML text, is it video, is it audio? So that is the information that your browser is going to use to render it. The browser needs to know what is the type of object that is being sent back to. Is it a textual object? Is it an image? Is it a video? And so on. So these are the kinds of HTTP responses that can come back to you, or the type of content. Okay. So another aspect of HTTP is how the client and the server communicate. So whenever a browser starts a connection, it will start up at least one TCP connection, okay, with the server, and then on the TCP connection, you'll send the HTTP request. Okay, let's say first time you contact a website, cnn.com, your browser will set up a TCP connection first, okay, then send your first HTTP request. Okay, what will come back is the main page, let's say it's called index.html. That page may have several other embedded objects. It may have images, it may have other things in it. Those haven't yet been retrieved. So the browser has to parse this page, see what are the embedded objects, and then retrieve each of those embedded objects in order to render it. What is shown in this picture is that for each of those subsequent objects, you set up another TCP connection, a separate HTTP request is sent. So this is basically what is called non-persistent HTTP connection. For every HTTP request you send, you first set up a TCP connection, you get the content, okay, send an HTTP request, you get a response, you tear down the connection. Okay? Then if that page has five other images, you set up five more connections, send off five more HTTP requests, get back the content, tear down the connection. Okay? That's one way to do it. That's called non-persistent HTTP. Here is another way to do it. You will see what has happened is, now in this case, there's only one TCP connection between the client and the server. Okay, you send off your request, get back the response, but then you don't tear down the TCP connection. You reuse it for subsequent HTTP requests. Okay, because there's no reason to tear it down if you're going to set up another one. You may as well use the one you set up. Okay, remember, there's a three-way handshake in TCP. Okay, to set it up, there are three packets that have to be exchanged that incur some overhead. Why incur that extra overhead when there's already a connection you had established? Then use that to send subsequent HTTP requests. Okay? This is referred to as persistent connection, where a TCP connection is not torn down when the HTTP response comes back. It is kept alive. Okay? So you may get, let's say, all of the content and you're viewing the page. After a few minutes, you click on another link. Okay? That connection is still alive and that link is going to the same web server, you can use the same connection and resend the request. Send the request on the same TCP connection. Okay, so you keep the connection alive for some period of time. Okay, and then after some period of inactivity, you have to tear it down. Okay, because you don't know if the user is done or not done. Okay, you have to keep some heuristics in the system to decide for how long are you going to keep this TCP connection alive. After you get the CNN page, should you keep it alive for 5 minutes? If the user hasn't done anything, tear it down. But then you may be reading a long article that you haven't finished, and maybe after that you click on the next link. Okay. Or maybe you glance through it and click on the next link, and then the connection is used again. Okay, so for how long to keep the connection alive is typically a heuristic. There is no guarantee on where or a specific scheme on when you can tear it down. You can only guess. So you have some sort of a timeout. If there's no activity on the TCP connection for that period, you will tear it up.
That's the most timely approach. Okay. What that also means is for very busy websites, there may be thousands and thousands of TCP connections that are still established, that are dormant, that are not doing anything. Okay, they're all consuming kernel resources. So the OS kernel has to keep state for every open socket. Okay. Each TCP connection is a socket. Okay, and so there are maybe lots of active sockets and there may be lots of dormant sockets. Okay. So it's the server's job to see if there are lots of dormant sockets, it can proactively start tearing down some connections saying there's too much state, it's consuming resources on the system and the resources are being wasted, so you tear it down and release some memory. Okay. So in some cases, the server may decide when to release the TCP connection. Now this is referred to as persistent connection, and this is done in HTTP version 1.1. Version 1.0 essentially required you to do this. Every request, new TCP connection. 1.1 said there's too much overhead of establishing new TCP connections every time, so you just piggyback your request on the same connection. It's called persistent. But in that you have to deal with this issue of when to tear down your connection after it's done. So that's HTTP. Any questions on HTTP? Yeah, very straightforward protocol. Yeah, all it's doing is you send a request and get back a content. So here are the methods that you have in HTTP. So this is the request. Request can be of four types. Okay, actually five. You can do a get request, put request, post request, delete request. Okay. Get is the most common type of request. You say get and say index.html or foo.jpg. That just says, get me this piece of content, or you specify request is processed, then content will retrieve. Okay. Put allows you to send some response. Okay. Whenever you fill a web form and hit submit, you essentially do a put request. That sends some content back. That's not requesting something, you're sending data back to the server. Okay. So web forms are basically sent through put. Okay. Actually, they're sent through post. So post is where you actually send a web form. Put allows you to actually submit a document to the server. Okay, you can, rather than retrieving a document, you can send a document. Okay. HTTP is similar to FTP in that sense. FTP allows you to download some files and upload some files. Okay. Post, so get is the download part of HTTP, put is the upload part of HTTP. Okay, if you have web DAV servers, which basically look like FTP servers running over HTTP, you will do get and put over HTTP. Okay. So put allows you to store documents. So post is what you use for a web form. Delete is not often used. Web browsers typically don't have authority to go and delete files on a web server. But if you're doing things like web dev servers where you can store content using HTTP, you can delete a file. Okay. So that's basically simply allowing you to store and retrieve content over HTTP. Okay, not for normal web pages, but these are used for sites that expose a repository that you access over HTTP. So these are the common types of HTTP requests. I'll show you some snippets in a little bit to show how this works. Okay, but before I do that, I want to say something about web services. Okay. Typically, most of the web requests are between a human and a server. Human uses a client to access content on the server. Okay. But there are many systems where the client is another server that is accessing content on a second server. Okay. In this case, you don't have a browser. You have one server that's acting as a client that's accessing a second server. And what they are doing is they're using what is referred as a web service to communicate between one another. Okay. So HTTP has become a way for servers to communicate between one another, just as client browsers can communicate with server. A simple example is, you may have a server one, where let's say that's an e-commerce store. Okay. Then a user comes and buys something on the store, gives a credit card information. Okay. Now the credit card information has to be authorized, and typically there's a payment processor that's run by a bank. Okay. So your website is going to make another HTTP request, hopefully encrypted, with your credit card information, and send it off to the payment system. Payment system will authorize it, send back a response. Okay? All of those interactions are happening over HTTP. And then what you are doing is essentially writing a web service where one server provides a service to another server and they all talk to accomplish some larger task. Okay? So the thing to keep in mind is not all HTTP communication is between a browser and a server. A lot of this communication happens between servers and other servers. Okay? And to write such systems, you are basically use specialized tools that basically resemble RPCs. Okay? And so you have, just as you have interface definition language, you have web service definition language. You'll see that there is a stub there. Okay? There's another stub here. Okay, so you can write these applications that use HTTP to communicate, okay, server applications that use HTTP to communicate in RPC style. Okay? Your RPC call and RPC response is simply being encapsulated as an HTTP request and an HTTP response. Okay, so this is RPC over HTTP. Okay, that's essentially what web services do for you. If you heard of things like SOAP, which I'm going to show you in just a moment, that's essentially a way to layer an RPC request over HTTP. Typically used when servers talk to other servers, make requests and expect responses. Okay. So here is a snippet that shows you what a typical SOAP message looks like. The SOAP messages are themselves written in XML. It's a markup language like HTML, but somewhat better. In that every tag, every snippet has to have a tag that describes what it is. Okay. So what this is basically an XML request that post sends off a message to some, let's say somebody's phone or somebody's machine, alert message. Okay. It is layered on top of XML, and this is becomes an RPC call eventually. And you'll see that there is an envelope or a header that says that's the time, that's the call, that's the name of the method. Okay, alert control is like the RPC method name. Okay, this is the SOAP method name, and this is the argument that you provide. Okay, this says pick up someone from school at 2 p.m. So that's how typically you will use a SOAP request, which is itself an RPC request. One server will send it off to the other server may have to send it off to a client or whatever it is it needs to do. Now I'll say a little bit about, you must have heard of this term RESTful web services. Okay, modern websites don't use SOAP, which is a bit too complicated. They use a stripped down version of SOAP, which is referred to as RESTful web services. Okay. SOAP is actually a very heavyweight protocol for doing web-based distributed computation. It allows one server to talk to another server over HTTP. HTTP requests themselves are SOAP messages that are written in XML. Okay, that's too complicated. That allows you to create arbitrarily complex distributed applications that run over HTTP. What RESTful web services do is it's a stripped down version that handles the common case where you have point-to-point communication. A client talks to a server. You don't need a very complicated SOAP protocol to do that. You can just use RESTful web services for a client to send a request to the server and get a response. Not a request for HTTP content, but a request that resembles an RPC request, for instance. Okay. This is very common when you write mobile applications. If you write a smartphone application, typically when it talks to a server, it is using HTTP. Okay. And the HTTP is basically written as a RESTful web service. Most web applications don't use arbitrary protocol. They simply use HTTP, which is common. And when you make a request through a phone app, it is going to go as a RESTful web request, which is going to look like what I showed you, the SOAP request, but a much more simple variant of that. So basically here also you have HTTP GET is to read, HTTP POST is to create, HTTP PUT is also to create, and you can use DELETE. Simpler than RPC style SOAP, and I'll show you some snippets here. Okay. So here is an example where you have a web client that is simply retrieving a stock price of a company. Okay, this is basically, so think of it as a call to a service saying, give me the stock price, the argument is the name of the company or the stock ticker. Okay, it's an RPC request that's going over HTTP. So here you basically say get stock price, that's the name of the method you call. And then you basically specify an argument, okay? And that's the machine it is going to go in. Okay, so you basically sign this off. And here is the response that comes back to you from the server. You'll see that the response is encapsulated as an XML snippet. Okay, you just don't send a number saying price is X. You basically encapsulate it into a certain thing saying this is a stock service, the ticker symbol is IBM, and in this case, this is the stock price is this value. Okay?
That's what is going to come back to you. You will parse it, then you will basically extract the necessary information, and then you will render.
This is an example of a RESTful request. So this was a simple RPC request you made to a server using a RESTful web service, and you got a response as an XML response, all textual. Okay. Now,
this has to be XML or you can use JSON also.
Okay, so that's a good point. So I just showed you one scenario of how RESTful web services work, where the object comes back as an XML object. Okay. Objects could have binary values in them. Okay. So there are other ways by which you can reply and not send an XML snippet back. You can send what are called JSON objects and many others. Okay. JSON is another very popular way where you can not only send textual objects but binary objects. Okay. Here, XML is by definition textual. So if the content is textual, you can use it. But many times you may be retrieving arbitrary content which may not all be textual. In that case, using these other ways to send back a reply, JSON objects are also popular. Yeah, I'm not going to talk about how to do that because the principle is very similar. Here is the corresponding, the same request sent as a plain SOAP request and a SOAP response. And you will see that because SOAP is more complicated, the request, which was just one line here, just said get stock price and IBM, has become a large XML snippet here. This is a SOAP request. Okay. That was basically a RESTful web request. Okay. Here is the full version of the SOAP request. This is what you would have to send. Okay. You basically, just the fact that you're accessing IBM, you would put all of this information. This is the response that comes back. The response doesn't look very different from the RESTful web response, but the request has become very bloated. Okay. And this is simply because SOAP by definition assumes that there are n parties that are participating in a distributed system. So each request is more descriptive, each response is also more descriptive. RESTful web services assume it's point to point. There's one client sending a request to one server and the response comes back to one server. So a lot of the unnecessary stuff has been stripped out, making it much simpler to use. That is why it has become more popular than SOAP, which is how most people started writing distributed web applications. Okay. So I should mention that SOAP is an acronym for Simple Object Access Protocol. And access an RPC method to access arbitrary objects. Okay. Quick description of SOAP versus RESTful web services. Okay. So this is SOAP, and that is RESTful web services. So SOAP is language, platform, and transport agnostic. Okay. RESTful web services are language and platform agnostic. The transport is HTTP. It is specified that you send that over HTTP. In SOAP, it doesn't even have to run over HTTP, although that's the default way by which SOAP requests are made. But so the specification doesn't say it has to be sent over HTTP. You could have written it over now, send that entire thing into some other kind of function call or an RPC call that you make. So it is meant for more general distributed computing. It's point to point, okay, no intermediaries, one client, one server. Here, there may be n servers that keeps processing part of the request and the response. Okay. There are lots of standards here. There's an interface definition language, a way to construct stuff, lots of tools available. Okay. RESTful web services don't have any standards, okay, specific standard. There are well accepted ways to write web services, but it's not standardized. You can write them in language of your choice. You can write it in Python, you can write it in Rails, you can write it in many other languages. Okay. But you have to do a little more of your own. Security is not specified, reliability is not specified. You have to use other mechanisms to provide all of these features. Okay. It is more heavyweight, this is extensible. Okay, this is, as I said, transport is tied to HTTP. It is much simpler to use and write. Okay, it's very easy. There are many web frameworks that make it very trivial to write RESTful web services. By definition, the communication is RESTful and web-based. Okay. So this is what you may actually encounter if you write any real web application. Whether you write it in Python, PHP, Ruby, or Rails, a lot of the communication uses a form of a RESTful API. Okay. So with that background, I'm going to spend the rest of the time. We're done with HTTP, web services, clients, servers, and so on. We'll focus just on the proxy. Look at proxies that employ caching. Yeah, so these are web proxies that are employed caching. I already mentioned what the web client proxy server architecture does. Clients always send requests to proxies. If the proxy has a cache, it looks at the cache, sends back a response for a cache, it goes to the server for a cache miss. Okay. Here is what cooperative caching does. In the last lecture, I briefly mentioned cooperative caches when I was talking about XFS. Here is how cooperative caching works in the web scenario. Okay, there's a single web server there. Here are three proxies that have been deployed. Okay, clients pick their nearest proxy and may send the request to the proxy. So let's say here is a GET request. Okay, it came from a client, it went to this web proxy. Web proxy says, do I have this content? That's in the GET, do I have that web page? If the answer is yes, you're done. Okay, you send back the response. If the answer is no, which is a cache miss, you can do one of two things. Okay, you can ask your nearby caches saying, do you have it? And if so, you get it from there rather than going to the server. Okay, and then if none of them have it, only then you go to the server. Okay. If you do this, then the caches are cooperating with one another to service requests. Not only do they service direct client requests, they also service indirect requests that other proxies make of them. Okay. Now doing this cooperation further reduces the load on the server. Because it may be that, so basically if you have cooperative caching, the cache that this proxy can serve is the union of the content on all the neighboring caches. Because either you get it locally or you get it from a nearby cache and you service it. Okay. And the assumption is for this to be a win, these proxies are closer to this proxy than the server. Okay. If these are more distant proxies, then you are actually going to slow down the request by retrieving it from a far off or a very distant proxy rather than the server, which may be closer to you. So the assumption is if you have lots of proxies deployed, it may be faster to go to a nearby cache than to a far-off server. Okay, but you have to go to a nearby cache, not a far-off cache, which will defeat the purpose of cooperation. Okay. So this is also often used in the web context, where you have proxies that cooperate with one another. Okay. Now having said all this, I should mention that much of these benefits of this caching only comes from static web context. Dynamic web content is generated on the fly. Okay? Often that content may change for every request because the content may be personalized. You go to you log into some store on the web. Okay, you may actually personalize the page by saying hello and it puts your name and you log in. Okay? Now if you cache that content and show it to someone else, that doesn't make sense because it's going to display somebody else's name there. Okay? So these kinds of content you cannot cache because they are personalized for each individual user. So only static web content you can actually store, because two clients accessing the same web page, so long as the page hasn't changed, will see the same response. For dynamic web content, two clients accessing the same page may get two different responses if the responses are personalized. Okay, there may be recommendation. You go to an Amazon page, okay, it's basically going to show you some recommended products based on what you bought. Okay, two users going to that page will see two different versions of the same page. Okay, no two users may even see the same page. Yes, because there's a lot of customization of the content, you cannot cache it. Okay, so a lot of these benefits do not materialize for content that is dynamic. Yes, this is something to keep in mind. Okay, but now having said that, let's look at how you can actually do this for caches. So this is your standard client-server architecture, send request and response. Client-proxy-server architecture, send a request. Okay, if it's a hit, you get a response. If it's a miss, proxy sends the request to the server. Okay, server sends back a response. You put that response in the cache, then you also forward a copy of the response to the client. Okay, this is something to keep in mind. Now we are going to focus on what happens if some content that is cached here is going to change at the server. Okay, this is the problem of cache consistency. Okay, you don't want to serve stale content. Okay, old web pages are not going to work. Okay, so we will see how to deal with that problem. Okay, so now what you have to realize is for static content, okay, there is not going to be one good answer of how to deal with cache consistency. There are many different approaches. It also depends on the content itself. Some web pages may rarely change or are infrequently updated. Others may change very frequently. You go to a newspaper website, every few minutes there may be a breaking news section that has some new content that's showing up. So you can, so the lifetime of a page is on the order of minutes before it changes. On the other hand, you can go to my web page, it doesn't change. I don't have time to do it. So for months at a time, it's not changing at all. So you can cache it for long periods of time and it won't be out of date. Very different lifetimes of pages. So this is typical of any web content. Some pages are very short-lived. They're updated frequently. Others are long-lived. They don't change very frequently. The creator of the web page is not going to tell you when they will change it next. So the cache, neither the cache nor the server have any knowledge of when the page is going to change next. So you can't typically assume that somebody is going to tell you, I'm going to change it next on Friday at noon, so I can store it for that period of time. That is not known. Yet you have to somehow decide how long you want to cache this content. Okay? So the problem is somewhat complicated because you don't know the age or the lifetime of pages. You know the age, but not the lifetime of pages. So different update frequencies, few minutes to weeks to months. Okay? So how can you maintain consistency in an efficient way? So we'll see two approaches. Okay? We'll basically see a push-based approach and a pull-based approach. Okay? We'll also see that regardless of whether you do push or pull, okay, what you have to essentially do when the page changes is either send, you can send two types of notification. You can send what's called an invalidate notification or an update notification. Then invalidate, you simply tell the cache, or the cache finds out that the page has changed. So you just throw it out. And then next time somebody accesses it, you bring it back. In an update, not only are you told the page has changed, a new copy of the page is sent to you. Okay, so you're basically said, here is the new version of the page. So that serves as a notification that the page has changed, and you also have the new content that comes with it. Okay, so you can send, so there are many design questions. Should you send invalidate or update? Should you do it as a client or a proxy push, or sorry, server push or a proxy pull? Okay, so we look at all of those dimensions. We start with a push-based approach. So in a push-based approach, it's the job of the web server to send, to maintain consistency. Okay? In this case, the servers have to be stateful. That's the first thing you have to realize. Okay, if the server has to tell a proxy when the page has changed, it needs to know which proxies cache the page. Okay. That is state you have to keep at the server. Okay, so this is a stateful approach. Okay. The approach is very simple. You track all the proxies that have requested any page from you. If a web page is modified on the server, okay, you are basically going to notify every proxy that has requested the page from you. Okay. Notification types could be you send an invalidate message, you push an invalidate message saying page has changed. That's what an invalidate message is. Page XYZ has changed. And the proxy is going to simply discard it from its cache. You could send updates, which is here is the new version of this page. You actually push the page. Okay, so you can do one of two things. Okay. This kind of invalidates are short messages. Okay. Updates are bigger messages because the entire page and its content is coming over. Okay. So you want to weigh the benefits of doing one or the other. Okay. So how to decide between the two? So you can say, if the page is popular, it's likely to be accessed, you may as well send an update. Because if you send an invalidate, soon after that some client is going to make a request for this page. It will result in a cache miss at the proxy. Proxy will come back to the server and retrieve that page anyway. Okay. So might as well save the proxy the additional trouble, send an update. Okay. So for popular pages, pushing updates may be better than sending invalidate. For less popular pages, the opposite is true. Okay? If you take the trouble of sending an update and send the page, the proxy may never see any subsequent request because this is a lightly accessed page, infrequently accessed page. So you put in all the effort to send the page, proxy doesn't need it. Nobody is accessing it. It's just going to waste your bandwidth. You may as well send invalidate and say, if somebody actually happens to request it, come back and access it. Otherwise, just discard it from your cache, and then that's all you need to do. So you can actually decide based on the popularity of content which one to use. Okay. Popularities may change over time, they are not static.
Yes, sometimes some pain may be very popular. After a while, people move on to other things and the pain become less popular. So it's not like the pain popularity is going to be constant. That also changes over time. Okay, so there are lots of dynamics that you have to decide with. Okay, but that's a push-based approach. Yes. Yes. So if the page has a higher update frequency than read frequency, then if you keep sending the page, you will send it lots of times and then it's read. So if you say if you're twice the time update frequency than a read frequency, it's updated every two times, it's read once, then it is better to send invalidates, because you'll, by sending updates, you've wasted the overhead of sending the page, doesn't get access. Send it again, then it gets access. Right? So typically the assumption is if you're seeing more updates than reads, better to send invalidates. Okay? Even if you see more reads than updates, even in that case you have to weigh relatively how many reads there are. If it's very popular, very frequent, you are okay sending an update. Otherwise, invalidate is always a safer bet in that case. Okay? Now, I should mention that push-based approaches are not part of the HTTP standard. HTTP doesn't say anything about caching at all. Okay? So all of this cache consistency has to be layered on top and it's separate. Okay? So as a system designer, somebody designing a web proxy cache or a server, you have to decide how to implement these schemes. So I already mentioned advantages, or several of the advantages and disadvantages. So what I did not mention also is server push approach provides better consistency, right? Because the server always knows when the content changes, because the content is stored at the server, it will actually see a write happening. Okay, you can immediately push updates or invalidates to client, so you can provide better consistency guarantee. In fact, you can provide relatively strict consistency guarantees. Okay, because as soon as the page is updated, you send off messages. Okay, and you are done. Okay. In this case, proxies are passive. The intelligence is all in the server. The proxies are simply receiving messages from the client, server. Proxies don't have to do much. Okay. Server is stateful. Okay, by definition, HTTP is a stateless protocol unless you're doing persistent HTTP. So you need mechanisms beyond HTTP to maintain the state. Okay. The last problem here is the state may have to be stored indefinitely. Okay. Because there is nothing in this very simple technique I mentioned which says when should the server stop notifying proxies of changes. Okay. So once some proxy has accessed the page, are you locked in for a lifetime, saying every time from now on for the next 20 years I have to keep sending messages? Because there's no mechanism here for the proxies to say not interested anymore, or the server to say I'm done, I'm not sending you any more updates. So state here is going to be long lived in the ideal case. Clearly you don't want to do this in any practical implementation, but the pure server push approach requires state to be maintained indefinitely. Once some proxy has accessed the page, if you want to do pure server push, you have to send either invalidates or updates from that point on. Okay? So that basically says that the state is only going to keep growing, never shrink. Okay? That's not going to scale at all. Okay, we'll see how to address that in just a couple of slides. Okay, first we are going to do pull, and then we'll see how to address all the disadvantages. Okay? So pull-based approach is all opposite. Server doesn't do anything. It's the job of the proxy to maintain consistency. The way a proxy maintains consistency is it periodically polls the server, has this page change? Right? Server replies as yes or no. If you say yes, basically then you have to discard that page, and then you can go and retrieve the page again. You can send a new get and retrieve it. If you say no, you know that the page has not changed. Whatever you have in the cache is what is on the server. So this is basically a pull-based approach. Proxy is completely responsible for maintaining consistency. Proxy periodically polls the server to the object has changed. The way you can do this cleverly is HTTP has what is called a conditional GET. Okay, by default, the GET request always fetches a response on the server. But in the GET, you can specify a condition which is called an if modified since condition. So you can say GET index.html, and you can specify an if condition, like if it has been modified since noon yesterday, and you specify a time. Okay.
So what that does is the GET will only send you a response if the page was modified after that time you specified. Okay. So the simple way to poll is you see when you retrieve the content from the server and you simply send a conditional GET to the server since that time. The page has changed, you'll get a new version. If not, basically it will basically say you have the same version, so I'm not going to send any new, the same thing again. Okay, so that's one way you can implement poll using HTTP. Now the big question here is how frequently should you poll? Should you check every minute, every 5 minutes, every hour, once a day? Okay. Depending on how frequently you poll, you will have different consistency guarantees. Okay, because the proxy doesn't know when the page will change next. Proxy can only make guesses. The proxy could be very aggressive and start asking every minute, every 30 seconds. For popular pages, that may be okay. But for pages that don't change weeks at a time, if you start sending requests every minute, you're wasting a lot of messages just checking as the page changes. As the page changes, then always the response is no. Okay, because the page is long lived, it doesn't change very frequently. Okay. So it is an important aspect in the client pull protocol to decide how frequently to poll. Okay. The opposite is also true. If you say you are going to be very lazy and poll once a day for very frequently accessed content, you will have quickly stale content in the cache. Okay. You will see them being cache hits, but the page has actually changed on the server you didn't bother to check. Okay. So this is a problem. So there are many ways to address this problem. Okay. One way is the server assigns what is called a time to live value to a page. When you retrieve a GET, when the response to GET comes back, the server puts a TTL, which is the expected lifetime of the page. The server can guess, the server also doesn't know when the page will be modified next. Okay, which that's dependent on the users who generate the content. But you can make an educated guess and send a TTL value. In this case, this is a hint to the proxy saying, check once the TTL expires. Then you can poll at that point. It's a good guess, not a guarantee. If the page actually changes and the server sends you a wrong TTL, you will have stale data for that period of time. So this requires the server to provide some TTL. If the server doesn't do a good job, you're stuck. Okay. The other way is the proxy can itself make intelligent guesses of how frequently to poll. So here is an adaptive or a dynamic method that decides what is the frequency of polling. So we'll assume that when you first got the content, neither you nor the server has any knowledge of the lifetime and it changes next. Okay? Let's assume some pages change frequently, others don't change frequently, or the frequency, update frequency can change that. So what you will do is you'll start being very conservative. Okay? Once you fetch it, you'll say, I'm going to poll frequently. Let's say you poll every 30 seconds. 30 seconds later you check, then has the page changed. You'll get one of two answers, yes or no. If it's yes, you assume, okay, this is a popular page, it changed 30 seconds after I fetched it. Next poll is also going to be after another 30 seconds. Okay. So you keep doing this. If the page is popular, you check frequently and you're good. And suppose the answer is no, you say, okay, I checked after 30 seconds, it didn't change. Next time I'm going to increase that value. Maybe I'll check after 45 seconds or a minute. Okay. You check again. Okay. If the answer is no, you further increase the poll frequency. So you keep extending it, okay, until you discover the rate at which the page changes. Because at some point you're going to basically get an answer, yes. Okay, at that point you say, okay, maybe I made it too long, I'll shorten it a little bit. You don't go all the way back to 30 seconds. But maybe you are polling every hour and the page changed. So you become a little more conservative. Next time you check after 30 minutes. Not an hour. Okay? And if the page hasn't changed, you increase it again to maybe 45 minutes to an hour. So keep varying the polling frequency to adaptively probe and discover the rate at which the page is changing. Some pages may be changing every minute, some may be changing every hour, may not, but maybe approximately every hour, some may change very infrequently. So this allows you to adapt the poll frequency. If you don't see changes, you become less, more and more lazy. If you see changes, you become more and more aggressive. Okay, so you will basically keep tracking what is the rate at which the page is changing. Okay. So this is basically going to increase the interval if the object doesn't change, decrease the interval if it doesn't change. It's adaptive, it needs no knowledge of the object characteristics. It adapts if the object characteristics suddenly becomes popular or less popular, it will adapt for you. There may be adaptation interval, but it will catch up after a while. Okay. So this is the best possible approach you can have where you don't need any knowledge from the server. You're simply discovering what you need to know by probing. And you will basically settle onto some steady rate at which you can start pages identically. And the popular ones get better treatment than the less popular ones. Okay. This is a dynamic pool-based approach. Okay. It tries to do somewhat better than wasting resources or giving no consistency. Now, having said that, you should realize that by default, this approach will give weaker consistency than server push. Because there's no guarantee when the page is changed. So between the time of the last poll or the time of the last update and the next poll, you will have inconsistent data. Okay, so this is going to be a disadvantage.
Once we get the fixed poll frequency, then it can change again or something like that if we don't get the updated data at that frequency, that time interval. It will decrease it again to 30 seconds.
So in this approach, you can basically become, if you make a mistake, you can again become more aggressive. The aggressive could say, I go back all the way to 30 seconds and increase, or I simply halve it or something, so it basically decreases it exponentially. Okay? This scheme is actually comes from, TCP has this AIMD protocol, additive increase, multiplicative decrease protocol to change your window size of how quickly to how much data you should have in transit. And the TCP probes for how much bandwidth is available and decides how many packets to send at once. Okay, because it doesn't know the bandwidth either. Same thing is being done here. Here the unknown is the page rate frequency. Right? And the assumption is you'll continuously probe. There is no guarantee that users don't tell you I'm going to only change it every 6 hours. They do whatever they want in terms of generating content. So you have to keep up. So there is no one answer that is going to be constant. You will keep on changing it. And once you make a mistake, you become more aggressive. If you want to be very aggressive, you reset it completely. Go all the way back to 30 seconds. If you want to be a little less aggressive, you decrease it by half. That's called a multiplicative decrease. And if you make another mistake, you decrease it by half. So you'll exponentially come closer back to your 30 second interval. Yeah, so that's basically how this technique will work. So pull-based approach, advantages, disadvantages, it's exactly the opposite of server push. So your server is stateless, proxies are stateful, disadvantages, consistency guarantees are weaker. The only way you can make pull-based approach give you strict consistency guarantee is that you check on every request to the proxy. Okay, that's the only way you can ensure. So request comes in, if it's a cache hit, rather than sending the hit back immediately, you still check with the server saying, I have a hit, has the page changed? Okay. Sort of defeats the whole purpose of having the cache. If you have to every way go to the server, you may have as well gone and retrieved the content. But that's the only conservative way by which this approach can provide stronger consistency guarantee. Otherwise, if you're just going to periodically pull, consistency guarantees will be always weaker. Not as good as server push, which immediately pushes notifications as soon as the object changes. The server knows, the proxy never knows. More sophisticated proxies needed. Message overhead may be higher if you basically set the poll interval to be more aggressive than it needs to be. You're wasting messages. In server push, consistency messages are only sent when needed, when the object has changed. Here, polling is basically extra message overhead. You're checking, but if the answer is no, that was a waste of a message. Okay, then you needn't have sent it. Not that you shouldn't, but you need it. Okay. So now we'll basically see how to get the advantages of both approaches. Both approaches have some good and bad. Okay, server push, better consistency guarantees, but bad from state perspective. Okay, you basically have indefinite state. Client pull doesn't have that overhead, but then it gives weaker consistency there. So one approach that combines the two is referred to as a lease-based approach. Okay? The notion of a lease is actually quite common in distributed systems. Lease essentially says this is a contract for a fixed period of time for something to happen. Okay? What is happening depends on the application. Okay? So in this case, the way it is going to work is that when the client makes the first request to the proxy will have a cache miss. It's never been requested before this page. So you go to the server and get the content. But you also ask for a lease on this page. Okay? Lease says basically, for that period of time specified in the lease, send me an updates or invite. Okay, so you can say, give me a 1 hour lease. So 1 hour lease says, the server is logged in only for that hour to send invalidates or updates. Once the lease expires, the server can throw away the proxy state. So this gets away from the disadvantage of a pure server push approach, where you're logged in for long periods of time, you don't know when to stop sending updates or invalidates to the client. Okay, here, you only have to do that for the lease duration. So while the lease is active, the page is changing, then you have to send invalidates or updates. Once the lease expires, then it's the proxy's job to decide whether to renew the lease or not. The page is popular, it will renew the lease. The page is not popular, it will say, I don't want any notification, nobody is accessing it. Okay. So in that way, it is the combination of server and client push. So there's an animation here. Some sort of animation is gone. The message sequence is the following. You send a read. You send a get with a lease request, you get a lease and a reply. The lease says you have basically this much time until which I send you responses. Okay, and then if there are invalidates or updates within that interval, you'll send it. Okay, at the end of the lease duration, you have to decide whether you in the proxy has to decide whether to renew. Okay. Now if the lease duration is set to zero, this becomes a pure client pull approach. Okay. The lease duration is set to infinity, this becomes a pure push-based approach. Because the lease never expires, you're same as server push. Okay, if the lease is zero, then basically you just get a request and the lease immediately expires. So now you have to poll or renew the lease the next time. It is basically client push. Now any duration in between is going to give you something that is between a pure server push and a pure client push. Okay. And so that's basically the hybrid approach between server and client push. So the efficiency of this approach depends on how to pick a good lease duration. Just as you have to pick a good TTL, time to live, you have to pick good lease duration. So for popular pages, you pick longer leases because you know the page is popular. Why let the lease expire and want to renew it? Pick a longer lease. For pages that you don't think are popular, start with a short lease. If you start seeing requests, ask for a longer lease. Okay. So there are many ways by which you can pick the lease duration itself. You can say, should I pick it longer or shorter, depends on the type of the object. So you can do age-based leases, which say the longer the lifetime of an object, give it longer leases. You can do frequency-based, more popular objects get longer leases. You can even make the lease duration based on the server load. Okay. The server may say, I'm heavily loaded. I'm going to only give short leases at this point because I don't want to keep lot of state and have to send lot of invalidates. So you can even adapt the lease duration based on the system dynamics. During periods of heavy loads, you have fewer consistency guarantees, but you cannot keep up. Other times, you can give longer leases than the proxy demands. Okay, so you can tune the lease duration based on any of these approaches. Okay, so last point here is cooperative caching. So I'm going to show you some animations of how this is done. Okay, so typically in a cooperative caching approach, you have a hierarchy of proxies. So here you have a two-level hierarchy where you have three of these proxies shown in the gray boxes. They are all caches. Okay, they are leaf node proxy and there's one parent proxy. The box at the top is the server. Okay, the lower level things are clients. There are many open source systems like Squid that allow you to just set up a web proxy cache. Just as Apache is an open source server, you get this open source proxy. They have cooperation mechanisms built in. Okay, typically, if you have more than one, they assume you set them up as a hierarchy. And I'm going to show you how this might work. So here is, let's say, a two-level hierarchy. This client sends a request for web page A. Okay. So first time around, it's going to be a miss. Okay. So since it's going to be a miss, then that proxy is going to ask its neighbors, saying, do you have page A? It's also going to forward a copy of that request to the parent saying, do you have page A? Right. Because messages are labeled ICP, that's an internet cache protocol message. Okay, ICP stands for internet cache protocol. It's like an HTTP request, but you're simply asking, do you have this page on? So then you're going to get responses which are going to be yes or no. Okay, so you get yes or no requests. Let's say initially nobody has the page, so all of the requests are no. Okay, so then what you do is, you basically tell the parent saying, I cannot find the page, you deal with it. Okay, so it's forward the HTTP request over the parent. This is a multi-level hierarchy. Same thing will repeat recursively. Okay? The parent will send it, ICP messages to its peers and its parent. Okay? In this case, this is two levels. So you already reached the root, so you will not, there's no recursion here. Okay, so in this case, the parent will simply go to the server, get the page. Okay? Page comes to the parent is going to send it to that proxy. The proxy will send it to the server, client. So these are all the sequence of messages that have to go on in order to service a first request. Okay, we'll see how to make that better. But so as you can see, cache hits are easy. Okay, cache hits basically say you make a request to a local proxy cache, it finds it, it sends it. Even this is called a local hit. Okay, even a remote hit is easy because if it, you don't get it here, you ask your neighbor, neighbor says yes, you get it and retrieve it. The problem with this approach is what is called a global miss. Nobody has it. Okay, request is slowly trickling up the hierarchy. Everyone is asking their peers. They are saying, no, this sends it up one level higher. By the time the page comes back, a long period of time has passed. Relatively long from the user's perspective. You're sitting at the browser, the page is not loading. Okay, because there are all these proxies that are simply asking one another, do you have it, do you have it? And then it goes to the server. Okay? So global misses, very slow. Local hits are fast, and remote hits are also fast. So then the question is, how can you optimize this so that if nobody has the page, better to go to the server quickly and get it rather than asking everyone and then wasting a lot of time in that process. Is the problem clear of this cooperative caching approach? When you have cooperation, you have to ask others if they have a copy of the page. And if nobody has it, and you ask a lot, have multiple rounds of asking other caches, then that wastes time. And from a user's perspective, you see slow load times because the page is not yet fetched from the server. So then the question is, how can you optimize this approach? How can you make global misses faster?
You can keep the threshold of the probe, like you can probe only these many machines or these many.
Okay, one thing is, you will say that you will be impatient. You just ask some neighbors, if you don't have it, you just go to the origin server and fetch it. That is going to limit or bound the latency. You will not keep on, if you have a 5-level hierarchy, you are not going to ask, have 5 rounds of asking. That's one way to do it, that bounds it. That's one, certainly an approach that is used. Any other ways to improve performance? Now that you know enough distributed systems.
I was thinking either centralized or distributed table or what you actually have in all the caches.
Okay. So that's a good approach. In fact, that is the other approach that I would have mentioned in the next slide. Is rather than asking, why not keep a table that actually you know what is where? Okay, why bother asking all the caches? Have them, whenever they put an object in the cache, have them tell their neighbor saying, I now have this page. So you simply maintain a directory or a table of who has what. Yeah, so that's basically the approach on the next slide, which is going to speed things up for us. Okay? Now we have the hierarchy here. I'm not showing any top level hierarchy, just to show a single level. So you are going to keep track of, this is the page, these are the list of proxies that have the page. Okay? Anytime any proxy fetches a new page, they tell their peers saying, I now have this page, you update this thing. Anytime you remove an object from the page, you also tell their peers, I threw this object out, so update your table. So the assumption is this table is sort of up to date. You know who has what, you know what you have, you know what your neighbors have. And now, when a request comes in, can you simply look at the table saying who has it? Okay, in this case, you see that A is at node X. So you basically go get it from X, you get back the page and you send it and you're done. Okay? You didn't have to first say, ask everyone saying who has it and then based on the reply, go get it. You even saved that time. And then if the table shows a global miss, because no, if the table says there is no entry for A at all, you know that nobody has it, you simply go to the origin server. Okay? So this does the same thing of cooperation, but by keeping this table around, you're saved on at least the global miss is easy case. You just do a table lookup. Nobody seems to have it, you go to the server, you don't waste time asking. And the hits are also easy. Most of the time, the table entry is up to date, it says node X has it, you will get it. Sometimes you may make a mistake.
because Node X may have just recently thrown out this pay, but before the table got updated, a request came here. So you will send it there, but then you are basically one hop extra that Node will get it from the origin for you. Okay, so as to mistakes are not going to cost a whole lot. Okay, but so lookups are local, hits are at most two hops, misses are at most two hops, and one if the hit is wrong. So this basically takes the same cooperative caching approach and optimizes it further. Okay, so I will stop here for today, and we will continue on the remaining slide or two next time. Okay. So just to repeat what I said, for those of you who came in late, lab 3 is out. Okay. I will put it up shortly after this class. It is actually due on the last day of classes, which is almost in 2 weeks. Okay. But I'm happy to give a no-cost extension to anybody who needs it. I cannot have labs due during week of finals. University doesn't let me. But if you need a few extra days, I can give you no-cost extensions, meaning that you won't be penalized for turning it in a few days late. Official due date will still be last day of classes. Unofficial due date, you can make it a little longer if should you wish to take that opportunity, the advantage of the opportunity. Okay. So we'll end here. Next Wednesday we have a class. Next week Monday there's no class. It's a holiday. Just keep that in mind. So let's stop here.